More news now. Concerns being raised over the huge cut in the proposed budget of the state university next year. That move will also affect the Philippine General Hospital as well as the Philippine Genome Center. See, these two facilities at the center of the country's battle against the pandemic, well, they're sourcing their funds directly from the budget of the state university. Let's discuss this issue now with Marikina Representative, Congresswoman and Economist Representative Stella Quimbo. Congresswoman Quimbo, good afternoon to you and thank you for joining us today.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and thanks for having me.
Okay, before we get into the issue at hand, I just want to ask you, how would you describe the budget as it was submitted to you? Is it truly reflective of the agenda to push the country post this pandemic?
Well, for one, there's a $500 billion increase. So at least that's a very welcome development, especially now that we need a lot of funds for COVID response. But we just started budget briefings yesterday. So we have yet to flesh out all the details, and we'll probably know in a couple of weeks.
Well, the pandemic has exposed a lot of vulnerabilities in the system. Very early on, we already knew it's going to have to deal with the education and health. We're going to have to put a lot of resources there. But here's the thing, a closer look at the budget by the Philippine Collegian revealed that the University of the Philippines, the budget for the state university was cut by 44%. First of all, what do you think about that? And second, what might be the consequences that will result from the budget cut of the state university?
Well, let me first clarify. The 44% budget reduction is a comparison between what UP proposed versus what was approved. So mm-hmm. they proposed a $36.4 billion budget, and what was approved was a $20.1 billion budget. So that's a difference of about 45%. But if we were to compare what the budget that was approved for next year, which is 20.1, with what they received last year, which is 21.5, it's a 6% reduction.
Okay. Right?
And normally, agencies, what agents post, they don't really get. That's pretty normal. But having said that, I worry about the 6% reduction compared to last year, because that means that many of the infrastructure projects that UP has proposed will not materialize. No, so that's and infrastructure projects, these are very important for the modernization of the university. I'm sure, Carmina, you know what I mean. You're from UP yourself. Modernization, I'm sure you can totally imagine what it means, not only in terms of common facilities, but also facilities like that would help in research and development, and particularly for PGH, there is a, for example, a 90 million peso project for fire protection. And we know that PGH had a fire recently. So now that they want to put in the protection system, that was not even approved.
Yeah, and you know, we only need to look back at the fire that happened recently, and it really breaks your heart because the hospital had to rely on donations, beg for donations, and even if it's just 6%, that's a lot, right? So what do you think? What was the explanation there? Were there any given at all to begin with? Why that reduction of 6%?
Well, again, you know, the details, that's known by the DBM only, and that will be known only during the budget briefing. So we only started yesterday, and it was just the economic managers presenting the macroeconomic assumptions for the budget. That's just where we are today. I have not yet seen the schedule for UP, but rest assured, this is something that we will ask.
Yeah, because really, when you've seen the comments, right? PGH gets the budget from the UP system. PGH is the main referral hospital for COVID. as things stands right now, they're really having a hard time. So where might this leave the Philippine General Hospital if the budget stays as it is?
Well, I think there's still some hope there because of the 1.6 billion budget that the PGH won't be getting, a big chunk of that is actually, I believe, in the 2021 approved budget, but is for late release. So there's a new category today called for late release, meaning it had already been released by DBM, but for some reason, it has not yet been released to UP. And that's in the 2021 budget. So if we are able to push that, there's some hope there. What we did was included for release in 2021 as part of their proposed 2022. So I think there's still hope there if we can push the release of those funds. Kasi I was looking at the list, Carmina. There's very important items like for medical equipment needed for COVID patients. There's a big amount that's intended for those, like respirators, I believe, or mechanical ventilators.
Yeah.
So those are examples of items that that are really clearly important today.
Congresswoman, you're an economist. When you see a new category or a new term called late release, and you're in the middle of the pandemic, and you know that the recovery shouldn't happen late, but should be happening as we speak, as we still deal with it. I mean, what does that tell you about how they're managing the funds and their utilization of the budget, Congresswoman?
Well, yes. As we know, now we've been seeing all of these COA reports of various agencies' disbursements, and the common finding is underutilization, which clearly is a very big sin today because not only do we have a pandemic, but every time we ask for funds from the economic managers, we ask for ayuda, we ask for assistance, the answer to us is there are no funds available. So in a situation where DBM has already released funds for projects that are already ready for implementation, but those funds are stuck somewhere and therefore not given to the implementing agency. That's a head-scratching moment, especially for Congress, because as far as Congress is concerned, in effect, Carmina, it's like effectively a veto, but without going through the proper veto process, right? Because Congress has the power of the purse. We approve a budget, right?
Yeah.
So we expect the executive to execute the budget. Mm-hmm. So if there are obstacles to that budget execution, like in this case, which is FLR, for late release, then that makes us wonder whether this is constitutional, meaning it's a way for the executive to actually veto something that Congress has approved. And in fact, anyway, there's a veto process, Carmina, as you know. It should have gone through that if in case it needed to be vetoed. And of course, Congress would have a recourse, which is to override the veto. But in this situation where no proper veto happened, but then in effect, seems like it's a veto, then Congress is hamstrung. It cannot even do what it can, which is to override.
Actually, the very basic thing of knowing the reason behind why they would want to veto that would be revealed had they gone through a veto process. But as it is, you don't even know what the reason is behind why those funds aren't being released. Speaking of the funds, and I don't mean to put you on the spotlight here, but do you have a figure as to how much is for late release? Do you have a figure there?
I know it's 1.2 billion for PGH. For the entire UP system, it's a bigger amount.
But for the entire, when you look at the budget in its entirety, not just for PGH, not just for.
I know it's somewhere in the 140, 150 billion vicinity. So I think for the entire UP system, it's 1.9 billion.
And for late release for 2021 or 2022?
2021.
This year?
This year, yeah. So it's been approved last year. I believe it had been released by the DBM, but it's somewhere in the system. And so it's not yet been released to the implementing agencies.
All right. And that this is happening during the pandemic, Congresswoman, what does that tell you?
Yes, we are missing out on a lot of opportunities for job creation, especially if it's infrastructure. Just look at the net of figures. The greatest multiplier is for infrastructure projects, meaning it's somewhere between 3 to 4 for every 1 peso that you put in for an infrastructure project translates to a 3 to 4 peso increase in GDP. And the nexus there is really job creation. Many of these construction projects are really where, our kababayans can participate as construction workers. And especially now that there's, I believe, 3.76 million jobless Filipinos, I'm sure many of them would welcome the idea of working in a construction project.
Later on, we're going to talk about the concerns of NEDA's Carl Chua about, you know, how this might affect the future of our learners now, this whole pandemic. But I want to go back to the cut in the budget of the UP system. How might that affect ongoing scientific research? I just received a press release a few minutes ago that the DOH, DOST, the UP system have been working together to expand biosurveillance capacity. With the cut, do you think that could be sustained? I understand that there's a budget for this already, but if there's this cut of 6%, is that going to sustain whatever scientific research is ongoing at this point?
Well, a big chunk of that cut, again, is capital outlay and MOOE. And I believe a lot of the research programs will be part of MOOE. So, and to the extent that UP, of course, is a center for knowledge generation, meaning the person who came up with the testing kits is from the UP NIH, right? Mm-hmm. We have a lot of our UP professors participating in this Okta research group that helps in data analytics. UP then, right? And then, of course, Philippine Genome Center, that's part of the UP system. So not only do we have institutions, but we also have individuals within the UP system that are all very essential parts of this pandemic response. And they're very small sort of atomistic units. And clearly funds would help in trying to like have a better, more cohesive system. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Congresswoman, a while ago you were talking about NEDA, and I want to focus on that now. There seems to be a concern, and it's a very valid concern, about how this pandemic will be affecting the future of the current learners. This is going to be a mark on their records, right? Whether you are going to graduate, you have graduated, or whether you are a learner currently during the pandemic. The education getting a huge chunk of the budget. Once you do go down to the budget of the education department, what will you be looking at to sort of address this concern of the NEDA regarding the future of our learners?
I think the first thing that I'm going to ask the DepEd is if there's a budget for a national assessment, meaning at this point in time, we don't even know yet how much we need to catch up. As we know, Carmina, in many other countries where internet is not an issue, it was not very difficult for them to transition from physical classes to online classes. Mm-hmm. And then that made education continuous. But in our country, pre-pandemic levels for internet connection, I believe it's just 25% of public schools. Many teachers, many students didn't have gadgets. And then in the end, we ended up with a hybrid system. And that hybrid system currently is not being uniformly implemented you know, even in my own district, right, and as you go from one barangay to another or one school to another, there are different ways of implementing that. No, and so because of that, you will expect huge variability in education outcomes throughout the country. So that's the first question. What's the impact? You know, in terms of learning outcomes, in terms of scores, in terms of math, Filipino, English, science, what is our baseline situation today, right? And based on that, then let's plan catch up, right? So I think those are the first two steps. The problem again is it's a very global economy today.
Yeah.
And as you know, one of our comparative advantages in the global economy is really our manpower. And so to the extent that education was disrupted, and that means after the pandemic ends in the global labor market, are we going to be as competitive as we were before? Right. And as you know, OFWs, they're our modern day heroes, diba? Baka after the pandemic, baka meron ng ibang countries ang mag-emerge as a better supplier of labor. So that for me is a question.
Yeah. And a shift possibly. Is that also something that the education and the labor department should be focusing on right now? Because, you know, we've always been diploma driven, but even during this pandemic, you can't even hone the skills because everybody is, you know, there's no face to face in some fields, right? So ang kinakatakot lang dito, I mean, the concern here is, as you correctly pointed out, we don't even know where we're at this point and past the pandemic. And so this might really have an impact on our labor force eventually, and the quality, not just of the labor force, the quality of the product that we're going to be churning out post the pandemic. What else are you going to look at? We talked about the education department. What about the labor department? They also have a huge chunk of the budget, Congressman.
Yes.
They have 44.9 billion. Go ahead.
And, kailangan talaga yon, Carmina, because at this point in time, again, many of our kababayans are jobless. And we're not only looking at those unemployed, and that's about 3.76 million. You're looking also at the underemployed, meaning, okay, they have some kind of a job, but yeah, then it's still bitil, meaning they can work more hours because what they're making is clearly less than what they're capable of doing in terms of hours and in terms of skills. It could be that you're a college graduate, but out of necessity, I end up maybe doing something that doesn't really require a college degree. So there's underemployment, and there's a lot of self-employed without workers, meaning to say, Carmina, these are salaried workers who lost their jobs during the pandemic. And then maybe just to make both ends meet, they end up maybe selling, they end up cooking, and then selling online. And they're alone. So they are self-employed. And technically speaking, they are employed. They're counted as employed. But then the quality of earnings is not going to be high. And more importantly, I think we have about 4 million of our kababayans who are unpaid workers.
Correct.
They work and they don't get paid at all, right? Mm-hmm. So, andaming levels of or different categories of not high quality employment. And these are the constituents of DOLE. So, there's a very big program called DUPAD, which we found very useful in for our district, for example. Mm-hmm. Many of our constituents have received that kind of an assistance for it's an emergency employment program.
Mm-mm. Meantime, we've been talking about budget cuts and the need for funding for post this pandemic, and then you see the NTFL tax barangay development program getting a huge chunk of the budget as well. Will you be looking into that?
Well, yeah, I mean, maybe as just like any other program, Whether what that program is receiving or not, it's sometimes difficult to make that assessment whether this particular program got a lot or not, right? Meaning the DOH budget is huge. I think they will be receiving 242 billion, right? So, but then to understand whether that's useful or not, well, you have to look, A, you know, the items that are the breakdown of the 242 for DOH, for example, and at the same time, relative to current utilization patterns, right? Mm-hmm. Meaning to say, do they deserve a super big increase considering that I think at this point in time, only 48% of their budget has been utilized. So the NTAC, as well as all other programs, that's essentially how congressmen and congresswomen, that's how we assess particular budget items.
Okay, final two questions for you, Congresswoman. You were quoted to have said regarding the budget, the higher it is, the better. The budget can be, as you said, a tool for recovery post this pandemic. But with what you're seeing right now, and as you deliberate on the budget, is it looking more of that, or is it looking more like something else?
Well, again, yesterday, one of the questions that was repeatedly asked to the economic managers is how much is the proposed COVID response? There's no answer yet. They said they will submit to us that estimate. There was an initial figure that was mentioned, which I believe was 395 billion, but that was a tentative estimate. So, but again, that's, as you know, Congress is pushing for Bayanihan 3, which is essentially an ayuda bill. And what the speaker wanted to do, Speaker Velasco is proposing a 1,000 per head ayuda as a first tranche. And that's already 108 billion pesos, right? And of course, when you think about pandemic response, it's not just ayuda. It's primarily your vaccination program. And at this point in time, it's your booster program. And one of the things which caught my attention in yesterday's presentation was that 45 billion pesos, which is a proposed budget for booster shots, is actually in unprogrammed. It's an unprogrammed appropriation, which means it's subject to fund availability, which, again, caught my attention. I was a little bit worried about that because at this point in time, although they say, hindi kasi kailangan mo unahin yung first two doses, but then budget execution starts in January. Mm-hmm. So if you got vaccinated June and may emerging consensus na kailangan mo ng third shot, so if that consensus becomes firmer by January of next year, we have to be ready with 45 billion pesos. So if it's unprogrammed, then that means you'll probably get that funding maybe later on, right?
So Congresswoman, does that show you that as they were working on this budget, that they once again lacked foresight?
Well, that their explanation is that, you know, there's a timing issue there. So anyway, that's something that I will continue to pursue. I'll let me find out if indeed there's some merit to their explanation that, you know, we can still wait. We can afford to wait.
Finally, concerns that the budget might be used not for economic recovery, but for election victory. How valid is that concern coming from the people?
Actually, what people should be concerned about is the 263.5 billion increased allotment for LGUs. As we know, those are the funds for LGUs used for devolved functions, right? But there's no clear monitoring yet at this point, or I have not seen it yet. So hindi natin malalaman easily kung paano ba gagamitin ng LGUs ang 263.5 billion na yan. Palagay ko baka dun yung may possibility na baka pwedeng gamitin for political reasons, for example, like increasement, etc. Baka doon pa rather than the national programs. Kasi national programs, that is more transparent to us. So kung sakali man mangyari yon, mas mababantayan natin. Mm. Pero yung pagdating sa LGUs, mas mahirap yun eh. Kasi napakaraming LGUs to begin with. And at the same time, hindi baliwanag kung ano yung benchmarks, di ba? Like, to an ordinary person, hindi nila alam ano ba yung responsibility ng isang LGU sa ilalim ng local government code na kung saan devolved ang functions tulad ng health sa mga LGUs. Mm-hmm. Hindi naman yun maliwanag sa ordinary citizen. So it's now more difficult to guard.
Okay, I'm sure we're going to be talking to you more as the days go by and as you continue to deliberate on the budget. But in the meantime, we're going to have to leave it at that. Economist and Congresswoman Stella Quimbo there, thank you so much for joining us today. Really, really appreciate it. Take care. Keep safe.
Thanks.